You love the creek, don't you?
Oh, I do love the creek. I grew up on it, and my people grew up on it, and it's just a way of life.
William Hurst's family has owned this piece of land along the shores of Hewlett's Creek near Wilmington since before the Civil War.
My great-grandmother had to knit the whole net. They did not have machines at that time to do that.
He has fished and crabbed these waters for most of his 80-plus years, and yet, after all that time, he still marvels at how the creek is alive and constantly changing.
Well, for instance, when you came here, none of that mud was showing.
Right.
And now the tide has gone out that much further, and you see bottom exposed that you didn't see an hour ago. Occasionally, we'll see two eagles that come in. Yeah.
Okay.
And the eagles, you know, they'll take the fish away from the osprey. They'll let the osprey work hard and catch it, and then they'll take the fish away from him, you know. Yeah.
Hewlett's Creek is what's known as a tidal creek. That means the water level rises and falls with the tides. And just off William Hurst Dock, that rise and fall is about 5 feet.
The creek itself is somewhere between 4 and 5 kilometers long from the mouth to the headwaters. And so you've got a variety of habitat complexes within this tidal creek system. You've got marshes, you've got oysters, you've got open sand flat, and you've got channels. And so that combination of habitat supports a variety of organisms that really depend on the tidal creeks as a nursery area. A lot of times we hear people say that estuaries are nursery areas, and what they really mean is it provides the habitats both for refuge and for food. That allows organisms to mature.
But what makes tidal creeks even more unique is that their water is in constant mix. A tidal creek combines stormwater runoff from the land with saltwater from the estuary. In fact, you could call tidal creeks the aquatic link between the land and the sea.
They're water channels that are tidally influenced. They get fresh water from wetlands and uplands, and they get saline water from the estuary. They're just very valuable and provide services, ecosystem services, if you will, that we don't get from a lot of other systems. They're very dynamic systems. They're constantly changing.
There are tidal creeks all along the North Carolina coast, and because the creeks are so closely tied to the land and the sea, tidal creeks are a sentinel of coastal health. That's why scientists are closely monitoring the health of Hewlett's Creek, because the land around the creek is being developed, and the stormwater flowing into the creek carries pollution.
Think about these things. 2 to 5 kilometer long mini estuary. Now, from a research perspective, it's a perfect natural experimental system. And so when we study these creeks of varying sizes up and down the North Carolina coast, we're really looking at, well, what happens to these creeks might tell us something about what's going to happen to our larger estuaries. Keep in mind the processes that are happening here on these smaller creek systems with development are the same processes that are happening everywhere. And so we need to be aware of what impacts might be coming down the road for our larger estuary system.
The oyster beds in Hewlett's Creek are key to understanding what's happening in this tidal creek and the dozens of other tidal creeks along the North Carolina coast. The oyster beds in Hewlett's Creek have been closed to harvesting for almost 10 years because pollution is creating high bacteria levels. But North Carolina Sea Grant is supporting oyster research, not only as a way to monitor the health of the creek, but also to study whether creating shellfish beds in tidal creeks would help to preserve the creek while at the same time help grow the shellfish industry.
Oysters are what we call ecosystem engineers. Their mere presence here changes the system around them. They stabilize sediments, they filter the water, they provide refuge in and of themselves. More importantly, they actually pull material out of the water column and they enhance the nutrient cycling within the water. So they're really vital. We're looking at the entire ecosystem and all those organisms that utilize that oyster reef as habitat. Oysters create a three-dimensional structure. And so one of the things that we do is we come to these reef systems, and we don't just look at the health of the oysters. We pull that oyster resource up and we look at what's living in, around, and underneath that resource. A lot of the animals in this tidal creek will hunker down during the low tide period underneath the oysters. And so what that'll tell us is, you know, the abundance and density and health of those of that community will tell us something about the health of the rest of the creek.
Researchers examine the oyster's size, growth rate, and condition. Initial findings show that while oysters can survive in tidal creeks, they are stressed. One indicator of that stress is the small amount of soft tissue found inside this oyster. Researchers also found a pea crab, which is a parasitic crab, inside the oyster. The stresses appear to come from stormwater runoff from the land, but no one is certain. Byron Toothman with the North Carolina Coastal Reserve hopes his monitors will pin down the source of the stress.
This is a multi-parameter water quality sonde, and so this gives you a single platform from which you can deploy multiple instruments, thank you, to take different measurements, and they are very interchangeable. Right now we have dissolved oxygen, turbidity, pH, and then here we have a probe that does temperature, which is this thermistor, and specific conductivity, as well as salinity. And then the batteries go in here, there's a circuit board, and this can retain all of the data for up to 45 days.
Those are all different aspects of water quality, including turbidity, which measures the cloudiness of the water from dissolved particles. pH measures the acidity of the water. Water that is highly acidic does not support life. And conductivity measures the ability of water to conduct electricity. A failing sewage system would raise the water's conductivity because of the presence of organic materials, such as phosphates and nitrates. An oil spill would lower conductivity. There are four monitoring stations strategically placed in estuaries at the mouths of tidal creeks around Wilmington, including Hewlett's Creek. They were installed in 1996 and collect data every 15 minutes. Researchers can know what was flowing into the creek by the hour, the day, or even several years.
As there are land use changes, the hope is that this will be one of our best ways to track the effects of those changes.
William Hurst believes that with all the science happening around him, researchers will be able to understand what is happening to Hewlett's Creek and how it can be preserved.
I can remember as a boy before there were outboard motors. So everywhere you went, you either had to row or pole or maybe sail, you see, and there wasn't as much human impact on the creeks as, of course, there is now.